So you're probably wondering why we're standing out here in the snow talking about soil. Well, it's the middle of March and this all will melt by the end of the weekend probably. And it's time to start thinking about your garden. And the trick to a healthy, thriving garden and yard starts with your soil. And we've got a soil expert here. You might even call him a soil doctor. So Paul, tell us a little bit about yourself.
So I'm Paul Grossl. I'm a professor of soil science at Utah State University. If you're going to take introductory soil science, you'll take it from me. I offer an online class in introductory soil science. Also teach soil and water conservation, urban soils. I've taught soil chemistry in a variety of other soils classes.
So, very cool. Yeah. Okay.
In terms of soil health,
and that's a big issue now. So where everything, your microbial, your chemical, and your physical properties are all in sync, and you have a very healthy soil. And the healthy soil will translate to growing good plants, and it translates to also good human health. But if you smell this, it has a really great soil. Those are actinomycetes. Those are filamentous bacteria. You got a little bit of...
Oh, did I get some on my face?
Right there. So what makes soil unique and different from rock materials is that it's unconsolidated. So that means it's loose. So if I were to grab that soil, it would have the solid matter as well as pore space. And the pore space is what holds the water and air and facilitates drainage and everything else. But I look at soil, if you're comparing it to the original material that came from the mountains that was deposited, most of it was deposited through rivers and streams here.
Okay.
I almost look at it as a natural painting where the material was brought in and then the action of climate, water, temperature, and that started acting upon that soil to create the soil that we have here now. So one of the main weathering agents to form soils is water. So it's the amount of water percolating through that soil that will also create the amount of biomass that grows on that soil and then start forming the soil as we know it. Mm-hmm. So here in Utah, we're in a semi-arid environment. So without irrigation, we're pretty limited in the amount of water, and the natural vegetation was pretty limited. So if we look at our original soils, they didn't have that much organic matter in them. Plus, there wasn't enough water to move through the soils to remove a lot of the calcium carbonate or limestone material.
Okay.
And that's going to control the pH at about, well, above 7. So,
Okay. And
since our pHs are relatively high, we're going to have issues mostly with our micronutrients like iron. And you'll see this often at gardens where there's plants that are grown that aren't native to the area, do have visual deficiency symptoms of iron, especially with maples. You'll see that intravenal chlorosis.
So you recommend a home gardener getting their soil tested to see what they need to do to like boost the health and quality of their soil?
People always ask me, well, if you're going to get a soil test, where should I start? What should I get?
Mm-hmm.
So the main things is soil texture, and I would recommend the official hydrometer method to get an accurate measure of texture. I would get a pH and an indication of salinity, which is what they call the EC value. We have salinity issues. That's also a part of being in Utah, especially with irrigated soils. And if your soils are poorly drained, you can have salt issues. For those that aren't familiar with what soil texture is, it's nothing more than the proportion of sand, silt, and clay in the soil.
Okay.
So what they'll do is they will sieve your sample as it arrives at the lab through a 2-millimeter sieve. So what they consider soil is anything that passes through that 2-millimeter sieve.
Hmm.
And then they have a test using a hydrometer to determine how much sand, silt, and clay, where sand is the largest of those particles, silt in the middle, and clay are microscopic particles, but they can get an estimate of that. Actually, not an estimate, they'll tell you exactly what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And then they can put that into a textural class.
Hmm. Okay.
So I think that's good to know, because I'll often hear people say, I have problems, my soil is heavy, but if you know what the textural class is, you know that you may have drainage issues.
And you might need to add more organic material.
Exactly.
And,
so organic matter is the remedy. I saw on your site, James Loomis had a video on compost.
Yeah.
That's one of the best videos I've ever seen on compost.
Really?
I'm going to use it for my class. Yeah.
James is awesome.
And
that's cool.
I would highly recommend his compost. So
he's the compost doctor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I really enjoyed that. Then I would also recommend a full metal scan. And the reason why I'm saying this is in urban environments, if you're near a high traffic area, that's one thing that you might want to be aware of, because pre-1985, everyone was using leaded gasoline. So a lot of the leaded emissions could be on your surface soil.
Yeah.
If you're near an older building pre-1980, there could be a very high likelihood of paint chips being around your home.
Uh-huh.
So I'm not sure if there was a home here or not, but that was pre-1978. I think it was banned in 1978. So that's another thing to be careful about. Also, as you get closer toward Harriman, where Kennecott is a lot of industrial areas, there could be more trace metals.
Gotcha.
And arsenic and lead. And that's about $33, but it's well worth it. It gives you some peace of mind knowing if your lead levels are low. If they're too high, there's things you can do about that. So texture, salinity, pH, phosphorus you get, of course, with that routine analysis, and an elemental scan.
And an elemental scan. And so your lab, usual, does that, do they do that tech, do they do all that testing?
They would do all of that.
Okay. On the usual website, you do have frequently asked questions. And so can you walk us through like how we would get soil samples from our garden?
Yeah. So you have a given area of interest, and you said your garden is this 4-foot strip here.
Uh-huh.
A strip this size, maybe no more than half a dozen.
Oh, okay.
Go to a depth of approximately 6 to 8 inches.
Okay.
And then what you would do is put each of those samples into a bucket, consolidate it.
So mix it all up.
Mix it all up. Pick out any rocks or coarse debris. This would be about 8 inches right here.
Okay.
So you get a scoopful.
Uh-huh.
And then you would just take it randomly through your area of interest.
And then you could just use a regular Ziploc bag?
Yeah, I like the quart size bags. I have one there.
Okay.
You probably want about 2 cups worth of soil.
2 cups worth. About how long does it take to get the results back?
It takes about, I'd say, 2 weeks. Oh, and the other nice thing about USU's lab is they give you a recommendation. So when you get your test back, it'll give you recommended amounts of nutrients to add, especially phosphorus.
Okay.
They do a blanket recommendation for nitrogen. So it's nice. You get a recommendation with your analysis.
Nice. Okay.
So if you have a soil that is higher in clay or
which is
higher
common
in
around
sand.
Here, which is common,
Compost is, in the end, without bringing in any topsoil, the way to go.
Okay.
And if you're going to bring in topsoil, what I recommend is you get material that has less than 30% clay, less than 70% sand, less than 70% silt, and focus on the texture first, because you can always add the organic matter.
Mm-hmm.
Via compost.
Okay.
Also, this soil is very well structured. And what I mean by that is you have these little aggregates and clods, and that means your roots are going to move really nicely through that soil. That's why organic matter is so great. It's great in aggregating our soil particles.
Uh-huh.
You'll get water, helps facilitate the movement of water through your soil.
Nice.
Aerates the soil, so this is very good.
So what would you recommend if someone was building their first, like they're basically building their first garden?
So what I would recommend is first get your soil checked. It might be that the texture of your soil is perfect. If the texture, again, is a little bit heavier on the clay or sandy side, then you would go and buy some of the organic matter or get compost.
And mix it in.
And
with
mix it in. To create your own, you're actually creating your topsoil then. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's interesting, you'll see the soil and it's as rich and dark as
it
yours.
Looks great.
I mean, it looks fantastic.
Yeah.
And as it turns out, their salinity levels are too high relative to what they're growing.
Mm.
And then what I also find out is that when we measure phosphorus, the phosphorus levels are pretty high. So what's happening is they probably have drainage issues. And often the salt load it's still a part of the manure or compost.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So I want people to be aware of, again, organic matter is great, but if you're starting to see issues with salinity and you haven't had those before, It's probably from
what the you're adding.
Yeah, and it's typically
because maybe horse manure might have a lot of salt in it.
Yeah, the ones that are the worst is poultry manure. Okay. But just be aware, phosphorus is good. It's a plant nutrient. But the concern with high levels of phosphate, especially bioavailable phosphate, is removal of that material into our water systems and then eutrophication of some of our receiving waters. And what you might want to do then is add other material. And you had mentioned, as we were talking earlier, blood meal.
Uh-huh.
And that's great because that's just the source of organic nitrogen and there's no phosphorus.
Uh-huh. Okay, cool.
Thanks for watching. For more fabulous videos and information on gardening, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. You can always find more information on our blog post at kued.org/moderngardener.